In Hitler, the Illuminati had found a ready-made stooge who could be the face of this autocratic new movement. And when the time came to put together a new secret intelligence service which was going to help protect all the money they had tied up in the German economy, these men also found one was readily available, the Order of the Skull and Bones at Yale University. Discussion of secret societies is something of a minefield because it so easily invites ridicule. It is very difficult for the general public to accept that the super-rich leaders of their Western world can possibly be as mad and deranged as they actually are. The public, generally speaking, are sensible and level-headed people who have to balance their checkbooks, so they inevitably tend to laugh at stories about Satanists and occult believers. But if you talk to any well-informed historians, they are all aware of the important role which various secret societies have played in human history. The Black Hand always played a pivotal role in the history of the Mafia. If you talk to anyone in the UK who was political and read books, they are always aware that the ruling class of Britain, including every member of the royal family, is a Freemason. And the emblem of the Death's Head was sported on the caps of the high-ranking Nazi officers from the very beginning. The symbols of these secret societies always seem to play around with some kind of skull and bones motif, so that it's abundantly clear what their mission statement is. These people are pirates, willing to commit any crime for big money. And they first became established in America at Yale University in 1833 with General William Huntington Russell and Alfonso Taft. Of course, being a secret society, they made other people curious about them, and in 1867, some undergraduates from a rival campus society broke into their headquarters to see what this skull and bones thing was all about. They reported that inside there were lots of lamps and candles, many dilapidated human skulls lying next to a fool's cap and bells, and it was morbidly dark because the walls were covered in black velvet. Having established a suitably satanic atmosphere, initiation rites were then performed on new members, who had to engage in group masturbation and sodomy while they lay in a coffin. Now, it's very easy to dismiss all of this as bizarre, silly, and irrelevant until you see the list of Skull and Bones members who have ruled America since Skull and Bones began. Although they only graduate 15 initiates a year, those 15 have always gone on to occupy the very highest positions in American society. U.S. Secretary of State William Max Evarts was a Bonesman, as was Treasury Secretary Franklin McVeigh, Chief Justice Simeon Eben Baldwin, and the 27th President of the United States, William Howard Taft. The founder of American football, Walter Camp, came through Skull and Bones, as did the very first chairman of the Federal Reserve, Pierre Jay, and director of Standard Oil, Percy Rockefeller. Averill Harriman, the son of E.H. Harriman and founder of Harriman Brothers, the largest investment bank in the world, was a Bonesman, and so were both of the George Bush presidents. During his premiership, John F. Kennedy was surrounded by Bonesmen like McGeorge Bundy and David Acheson, son of Dean Acheson. Kennedy knew these men refer to each other as brothers under the skin. They swear an oath of secrecy and then ruthlessly vow to help each other's careers in any way they can throughout their lives, even if it means committing murder. In Britain, every literate person knows that all of the top police officers are Freemasons, because if there are 10 candidates for a top job, a Mason will always select a brother Mason for the post. Skull and Bones works the same way, and JFK took this problem so seriously that he even made speeches warning America about the danger of secret societies.
The very word secrecy is repugnant in a free and open society, and we are, as a people, inherently and historically.
He knew the people on this list were neither silly nor irrelevant, because he knew they were the real holders of power in America, operating as they were, as an unelected shadow government, accountable to no one. simply by looking at the cover of Fritz Thyssen's book, I Paid Hitler, on which he is depicted as a puppet master controlling Hitler's strings. Thyssen was a billionaire industrialist. He was the man who built the Bismarck. His company, United Steelworks, made 3/4 of all Germany's steel, and he joined together with Skull and Bones members Prescott Bush and George Herbert Walker to financially assist the Nazi Party. Together, they recruited head of the German Central Bank, Hjalmar Schacht, to the fascist cause, and then combined with other leading industrialists to sign the letter which convinced Hindenburg to appoint Hitler as Chancellor on the 20th of February 1933. Had anyone inquired around this time about the postal address of the Nazi Party, they could legitimately have been told that it was 39 Broadway, Manhattan, New York, because this was where Averell Harriman, Prescott Bush and George Herbert Walker kept their office. And being no fool, Fritz Thyssen used their banking services to set up secret cash funds funneled through another bank in Rotterdam, the Bank voor Handel en Scheepvaart, to finance the building of the first official Nazi Party headquarters, the Brown House. This was all done with the full cooperation of the Dutch bankers, who orchestrated this entire sinister business with the assistance of the Thyssen family lawyer, Alan Dulles. Of course, the Germans themselves were ecstatic. We've all seen the newsreels from that time in which they are stomping around in their jackboots, acting like a master race, because they had swallowed the propaganda that they were being led to glory by a superman who had rebuilt the economy and Germany's infrastructure all by himself. This was a lie. Hitler didn't have any money. You can only build autobahns with one thing, capital investment, and that investment came mainly from America. The Nazis were also given a lot of help from the City of London, help which came mainly in the shape of Sir Montague Collett Norman, Governor of the Bank of England. Norman was connected to Bush and Walker through the merger of Harriman's with the Brown Brothers, who traded in London as Brown Shipley, hence Brown Brothers Harriman. The people behind this multinational investment bank had a long-standing racial tradition. Few British people at the time were aware that they only enjoyed relatively cheap clothing because it was all made from slave cotton brought from America on the Brown Brothers ships and sold to British mill owners. Montague Norman was heir to this colossal Brown Brothers fortune. As the de facto head of world banking, he made no secret of his only being interested in the richest 1% of people. And even as the newspapers began to fill with stories of Nazi concentration camps, he still declared himself to be Hitler's most avid supporter. "We must lend Nazi Germany 90 million marks," he declared. "It may never be repaid, but it will be less of a loss than the fall of Nazism." One might have thought Sir Montague's close personal friends, the royal family, would have been outraged by his comments. Nothing could be further from the truth. It is part of the remit of this film to try and make people aware of the tricks the rich play in order to control how we think. George Orwell once said that the ruling class in every age have tried to impose a false view of the world upon their followers. And there's no better example than the way in which the British have been duped into believing that their royal family are called Windsor and descend from English kings like Henry VIII. The British royal family are, actually, German, and their real name is Saxe-Coburg-Gotha. The only change it to Windsor after Windsor Castle in 1917 to hide the fact that they were German during the First World War. Prince Harry, in honour of his German roots, has been known to dress as a Nazi on several occasions. Dozens of critics have pointed out that the Duke of Edinburgh's brother was the head of the Nazi SS. And King Edward VIII, before he abdicated to marry the American divorcee, Wallis Simpson, visited Hitler to make it abundantly clear to the whole world that he too was a Nazi. He even signed his name Herzog von Windsor. Thinking people during this period realized that this whole thing with kissing up to the Führer somehow transcended national boundaries. The rich people from the most diverse countries had bonded together because they all shared a common goal. The kings and the queens and the international bankers and industrialists wanted to make certain communism could never succeed. They were determined they weren't going to finish up like the Russian royal family. And they were determined to hang on to their money. They were much more afraid of the ordinary working people in their own countries than they were of fascist Germany. And this prevailing sentiment amongst the world's ruling class led America's elite to attempt a fascist coup d'etat in 1934. I hope it will be plain to people by now that Hitler's economic miracle is the greatest myth in human history. There was no economic miracle. There are no miracles. And if there are, why can't the Germans do it all again now? If you want to construct a network of new roads and new steelworks and new factories, you need one thing, money. You need investment. And the investment didn't come from Hitler. It came from Brown Brothers Harriman and their business associate, Fritz Thyssen. It came from Hjalmar Schacht and his best friend, Sir Montagu Collett Norman. It came from men like Axel Wenner-Gren, the Swedish multimillionaire arms manufacturer, and Charles Bedeau, the French business mogul. These people were all in the same bed with their Nazi friends, the Duke and Duchess of Windsor, the Dulles brothers, Prescott Sheldon Bush, and George Herbert Walker, with whom they'd created the Union Bank for laundering Nazi money. And with stage one of their plan for world domination complete, they now turned to the second phase, which was meant to be the overthrow of American democracy and the imposition of fascist government upon the United States. In order to pull this off, these Nazis raised money from America's richest families, many of whom, in this new consumerist society, had become household names. The Colgate family, the Birdseye family, the DuPont family, the Rockefeller family. These people handed over millions to the American financiers of Hitler so they could hire, train and supply a private army which would attempt to overthrow the democratically elected government of Franklin Delano Roosevelt and impose fascist dictatorship in America. Of course, it's natural to wonder, considering they had such advantages, how on earth they failed to pull it off. The simple answer is that they chose the wrong man, because their choice to lead this Nazi insurrection was Major General Smedley Darlington Butler, the most decorated soldier of the period and in all of American history, perhaps the most unsung hero of all. Because Smedley Butler was the most genuine Democrat and lover of liberty the world has ever seen.
I appeared before the Congressional Committee, the highest representation of the American people, under subpoena to tell what I knew of activities which I believe might lead to an attempt to set up a fascist dictatorship. The plan as outlined to me was to form an organization of veterans, to use as a bluff or as a club at least, to intimidate the government and break down our democratic institutions. The upshot of the whole thing was that I was supposed to lead an organization of 500,000 men, which would be able to take over the functions of government. My main interest in all this is to preserve our democratic institution. I want to retain the right to vote, the right to speak freely, and the right to write. If we maintain these basic principles, our democracy is safe. No dictatorship can exist with suffrage, freedom of speech and press.
Smedley Butler tricked the plotters into thinking he was interested for just long enough until he was sure who all the major players were, and then he told the president. This put FDR in a quite impossible position. America at that time was just coming out of the Great Depression. The last thing he wanted was to cause another economic downturn, and he feared that if he scooped up all the leading bankers and captains of industry in the United States and threw them all in jail, the country just might fall apart. So what could he do? To Smedley Butler's utter incredulity, he chose, in the end, to do nothing. In spite of the fact that these men had committed treason and should have been hanged, their power was such that they were not even charged, let alone tried, and so great was their influence, they were able to keep America out of the war until December the 7th, 1941. With the Japanese attack on Pearl Harbor, Roosevelt finally realized he had to do something. His response was the Trading with the Enemy Act, which allowed him to seize assets like the Union Bank, through which Bush, Walker and Harriman had been financing Thiessen. Roosevelt didn't realize, however, that it was already a case of too little, too late. Because without his knowledge, American business moguls had been tumbling over one another for 2 years in their efforts to assist and do business with the Hitler regime. Typical of this American spirit of enterprise was Sosthenes Ben, the president of AT&T, who flew immediately to Berlin when war was declared to put in Hitler's phone lines. He gave the Nazis the most high-tech, state-of-the-art telecommunication system in the world at that time, so that Hitler could rule the European mainland with the maximum efficiency. Rich men have been hiring thugs to do their dirty work, especially to frighten people, since human civilization began. What people have to try to appreciate is that Nazism, in reality, was simply the first time in human history that the rich had enough wealth to hire an entire country of thugs to do their dirty work. Some of the most emotive images in world history are those of the Nazi war machine sweeping across the Low Countries to begin their occupation of France. And people have always assumed that the trucks used for the miles-long troop convoys must have been German trucks. But if anyone at that time had taken the trouble to lift up the cowling and look at the engine, they would have found these were actually Ford trucks, which had been built with personal permission from Henry Ford, who was sitting in his office 4,000 miles away in Dearborn, Michigan, a service for which he was given the Grand Cross of the Eagle, the highest honor the Nazis ever bestowed on a civilian.
Ford sued the U.S. Army, the U.S. government in the 50s, because during the war, the U.S. Air Force bombed their tank-making facilities in Germany. And this is true. And what was it, like 52 or something? They sued the U.S. government for destroying their factories. And they won. They won the lawsuit. So I had to write a little song for Henry here.
Ford built tanks for the Nazis, and the Nazis used those tanks to gun down lots of soldiers in the U.S. Army ranks. Yes, Henry Ford was a fascist, and a nasty one was he. He built tanks for anyone for the proper fee. Henry
Ford. Hitler so admired Henry Ford, he kept a life-size portrait of him on the wall next to his desk, and even his legendary Panzer tanks were tainted by these sorts of practices, because they were made by I.G. Farben, who had entered into a cartel with the Rockefellers, Standard Oil. The government in Washington knew all about this, and largely did nothing. Licensing arrangements for trading with the enemy in wartime were issued without any fuss, even to the extent that after the occupation of France, the Chase and Morgan banks in Paris simply carried on doing business as usual. The incredible truth, which the rich elite have managed to hide from the world for 70 years through their control over school books and our education system, is that the Nazi war machine was actually an American business. And for the Rockefellers, DuPonts, Harrimans, Walkers and Bushes in particular, it was a highly lucrative business. For their part, Coca-Cola's contribution to the war effort was to sell billions of soft drinks to the thirsty Nazis while they were strafing and bombing Allied soldiers, particularly in very hot regions. In the desert, where refrigerators tend to be scarce, there were even stories of Messerschmitt pilots wrapping wet towels around bottles of Coke, tying them to their aircraft, then flying up to altitude, where the cold and the wind chill turned the wet towel into a solid block of ice. They would then dive down, crack open the towel, and enjoy an ice-cold Coke in the desert. If they had wanted to, the Western multinationals could have grounded the Luftwaffe and stopped the war at any time, because the German aircraft were totally dependent on imported supplies of tetraethyl lead, an additive which prevents knocking in aero engines. But Standard Oil kept the supply of this vital resource going through neutral Switzerland for the entire war. And any Dutch people who might be wondering at this point what kind of percentage the Swiss took from this little arrangement, they need to be aware that thanks to Prince Bernhard von Lippe of the Netherlands, the father of the recently retired Queen Beatrix and prominent member of the Nazi Party, Royal Dutch Shell gave Hitler millions of tons of crude oil for nothing. The Dutch royal family actually fueled the invasion force which annexed Holland and were instrumental in helping the Nazis to rape their own country. But most shocking of all is the truth of what really happened in the little Polish town of Oświęcim. This sleepy little hamlet just happened to be in an extremely mineral-rich region, particularly for coal, which Western industrialists had wanted to get their hands on for years. With the coming of the Hitler regime and the invasion of Poland, the fascist financiers had the bright idea of turning this conquered region into an investor's paradise by building a Nazi concentration camp near the town and utilizing the slave labor available to drastically reduce their own production costs. Few people are aware of the gigantic scale of the Nazi concentration camp network and are blissfully unaware that the real purpose behind their construction was to make a profit for the rich, which is why they stole all the gold watches, gold wedding rings and gold teeth fillings and melted them down into gold ingots. To this day, there are bars of gold lying in the vaults of the Bank of England, which have the Nazi swastika stamped on them. Gold stolen from Jewish corpses. It shouldn't come as any great surprise that George Herbert Walker's family were slave owners on the cotton plantations of 1930s America. Walker was used to organizing slave labor. So while his business associate, Averill Harriman, was paying for Hitler's 500,000 SS troops and supplying them all with brand new Thompson submachine guns, because he did, Walker took over the management of this new Polish concentration camp. And when his Nazi friends started complaining that they couldn't pronounce the name Oświęcim any better than I can, they all got together and decided they had better Germanize the name into something which sat more comfortably on Nazi tongues. It was in this way that the world first heard of Auschwitz. Because the truth about Auschwitz and the entire Nazi war machine is that they were essentially no different to McDonald's. They were American business enterprises abroad, businesses which the richest European families invested in, and businesses which, because of slave labor, made obscene profits, which Prescott Sheldon Bush took and placed in a blind trust, which later financed a Bush political dynasty, which produced two presidents of the United States, his son, George Herbert Walker Bush, and his grandson, George Walker Bush. This picture of the railway leading into Auschwitz has, since World War II, become the iconic image of the Holocaust. To us, it now represents something like the gate to hell. But how differently, one wonders, would we have looked at this image all of our lives if we had always known that this railway line was an American railway line laid by the Harriman brothers on behalf of Uncle Sam. The Standard Oil IG Farben cartel even made the Zyklon B gas for the Jewish Holocaust. Now, anyone who at this point is thinking that all this simply cannot be true, because if it was, someone would have sued, well, someone did. This information came into the public domain because of a Dutch intelligence agent who was so disgusted when he found all of this out, he leaked it to the press, as a result of which two very senior Jewish gentlemen, Kurt Julius Goldstein and Peter Gingold, filed suit against the American government. Of course, the more discriminating among us will now be asking how it can be that this story went completely unreported in the mainstream media. One might just as well ask why the Times in London was writing favorable stories about the Nazi concentration camps throughout the 1930s, and why Lord Rothermere was still referring to Hitler as a great gentleman as late as 1940. You really would think by now that people would have realized that it isn't so much the bias in the media which really matters, It's the things they know about, but never tell you, that really matter. Because the truth is that the press knew exactly what was going on in the concentration camps all through the war. They never said a word about it, because they knew who was making money from the slave labor. Now, it's very easy to imagine what the response of a conservative politician, American or British, would be to all of this. If all of this is true, he's bound to ask why nobody said a word about American industrialists building Hitler's war machine at the Nuremberg trials. How come it never got mentioned?
Where's the responsibility of the Vatican, who signed in 1933 the Concordat with Hitler, giving him his first tremendous prestige? Are we now to find the Vatican guilty? Where's the responsibility of the world leader Winston Churchill, who said in an open letter to the London Times in 1938, Your Honor, were England to suffer national disaster, I should pray to God to send a man of the strength of mind and will of an Adolf Hitler. Are we now to find Winston Churchill guilty? Where's the responsibility of those American industrialists who helped Hitler to rebuild his armaments and profited by that rebuilding? Are we now to find the American industrialists guilty? No, Your Honor, no! Germany alone is not guilty. The whole world is as responsible for Hitler as Germany. It is an easy thing to condemn one man in the dark. It is easy to condemn the German people, to speak of the basic flaw in the German character that allowed Hitler to rise to power, but at the same time, comfortably, ignore the basic flaw of character that made the Russians sign pacts with him, Winston Churchill praise him, American industrialists profit by him, American industrialists profit by him, 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 profit by him.
In school, we are taught that the Allies defeated Nazi Germany in World War II. This is not true. The Nazis won the war. Because the real Nazis, the rich, played on both sides. That's what a rich businessman does. He arranges things so that he is well thought of by both sides. So then whoever wins, he wins. And his money is safe. Now, a lot of people will still think it is simply ludicrous to suggest the Second World War was a phony war. They are bound to say that no one who was there at the time thought it was a phony war. Really?
A new baby, 200 gross of buckles, unlimited petrol, and all the whiskey you want.
You're sitting pretty, aren't you, Holden? Yes, it is a lovely war.
Well, wouldn't you if you were in my place? Wouldn't everybody? Doesn't everybody?
The war's a blasted phony anyway.
I'm a bit tired of that.
Tired of what?
This phony war business.
Well, isn't it?
No, it's not. I've just come out of hospital after 10 days in an open boat off the Faroes, and I'm sick and tired of blokes like you with soft jobs ashore. Come outside.
Now, don't be silly.
I've lost two fingers off that hand, but I'm going to take you outside and knock your block off with my right.
Oh, take it easy. There's no need for that.
I'm sorry, I apologize. I'll come outside if you insist.
That won't do any good. It's not his fault. It's the fault of all of us.
You make me sick. All of you. It may be a phony war to you, but it's not to all the boys at sea. It never has been.
Now, obviously, the British, and the Dutch in particular, will have a very hard time accepting that their royal family profited from Nazi concentration camp slave labour. But if you go online, there is so much about this on the internet now. It's become plain that historians are more and more proving that those days were really all about the Western world's rich coming together to fund a Nazi war machine which was meant to protect them from the Soviets. The Duke of Edinburgh practically admitted this when he said, in those days we were anti-communist because the Russians killed half my bloody family. And when this cabal of secret Nazis got together to discuss how they were going to pay for this Nazi war machine, because rich people never accept a loss, they hired a psychopath, Hitler, who they knew would go along with their building concentration camps so that slave labour would pay for all the planes and the tanks and the guns. And you can see in the more intelligent movies from that period, like Hitchcock's Saboteur, that the artists and writers of that time knew the rich were fascist and completely understood what they were really up to.
Why is it that you sneer every time you refer to this country? You've done pretty well here. I don't get it.
No, you wouldn't. You're one of the ardent believers, a good American. Oh, there are millions like you. People that plod along without asking questions. I hate to use the word stupid, but it seems to be the only one that applies. The great masses, the moron millions. Well, there are a few of us who are unwilling to just troop along. A few of us who are clever enough to see that there's much more to be done than just live small, complacent lives. A few of us in America who desire a more profitable type of government. When you think about it, Mr. Kane, the competence of totalitarian nations is much higher than ours. They get things done.
Yeah. They get things done. They bomb cities, sink ships, torture and murder so you and your friends can eat off of gold plate. It's a great philosophy.
I neither intend to be bombed nor sunk, Mr. Kane. That's why I'm leaving now. And if things don't go right for you, if we should win, then I'll come back. Perhaps I can get what I want then. Power. Yes. I want that as much as you want your comfort or your job or that girl. We all have different tastes, as you can see. Only I'm willing to back my tastes with the necessary force.
That the Fat Cats were fully aware that Americans will do anything for patriotism. Hence, you must always provide them with an enemy, a boogeyman. They won't overwork themselves just to make huge profits for Fat Cats for any other reason. So new enemies had to be found or created. This is what Joe McCarthy's Reds Under the Bed scare had really been all about. And they used the same excuse in Laos, Chile, Guatemala, El Salvador, Iran, Honduras, Vietnam, and Cuba. If a small country refused to go along with American business interests, which basically meant with the rights of Western multinationals to pay slave wages to third world peasant farmers growing commodities like tobacco or sugar or fruit, they simply labelled them as communist, assassinated the democratically elected head of state with teams recruited from their secret societies, the Central Intelligence Agency and the Mafia, and political attitude manifest itself in the way the gangsters supported the campaigns of both leading candidates in every political head-to-head, in order to make sure that whoever got elected, he was always their man and on their side. So this was the real political world which the young Senator John F. Kennedy became a part of in 1950s America. It was a world ruled by a super-rich cabal of secret Nazis who had built the fascist war machine and concentration camps purely to protect themselves and their money from socialist Russia. Having avoided prosecution for the greatest crime in human history, they were confident that they could kill anyone and get away with it, particularly if it was someone who might interfere with their power to instigate phony wars in order to make huge fortunes by lending money and selling weapons to both sides.
Order. We have before us the opportunity to forge for ourselves and for future generations a new world order. A world where the rule of law, not the law of the jungle, governs the conduct of nations. When we are successful, and we will be, we have a real chance at this new world order, an order in which a credible United Nations can use its peacekeeping role to fulfill the promise and vision of the UN's founders.